thought, oh my god, if we lose this, we're out. Has that ever entered into your mind, like Sinarin said, are you just thinking about the team, you're thinking about how you're going to play?
I don't think it's something that you think too much of. I didn't, at least. It's more of a, you got your back against the wall, you know you have to perform, and it's really a great motivator, but I think it also varies from player to player and team to team.
Sure.
So I don't... I'm not saying it's necessarily holds true for neither LGD or EHOME, but as William said, on the Chinese forums there was a rumor going that EHOME seemed very confident, regardless of whether they had to play their way up from the lower bracket or go through the winner bracket.
Yeah, I think most of the time when teams are in the lower bracket, a lot of people say, oh man, they have to go through so many different teams, but if EHOME truly believes that they're meant to be in the top four, they don't really care the road that they have to take to get there.
We're in the draft, and as ever, these two teams are flying through it. Four bands, this all the same bands that we had before, of course.
Strikingly similar.
And it's different. Almost the same until we get to pick three.
So this time they didn't go for the Ember.
Why do you think that is? Because I don't think Lanham was necessarily playing a great Bane game.
No, but I think Bane is just a really good control hero. It's a hero that you have to work yourself around. You have to worry about the constant threat of him just right-clicking your mid-hero out, and like we talked about, for me personally, it kind of feels like a core matchup, or it's going to be the maybe versus CTY, and if you're able to slow down maybe in the mid lane a little bit, maybe this gives CTY some confidence going in.
We've seen more and more of Bane over the days, as the days have gone further through the Frankfurt Major. Early on, I think the first 2 days, many of you were saying, we haven't seen enough Bane.
He was banned out in a lot of the games, especially a team like Team Secret had Bane banned against them. Out of respect, I think, because it was the support hero that they seem to have the most success on, and it's been one of the absolute best support heroes as well, both in terms of win rate and also just like if you look at the details of the hero, it's just so incredibly difficult to deal with.
The reason it's got so much back into the metagame was the last patch, where it got a very significant buff to Brain Sap. The mana cost was lowered a lot, and it allows you to sustain way better in lane. Bane's old innate disadvantage was that his abilities were so expensive, all of them, that you could barely get each of your spells off once, and then you would have to itemize directly to get mana, and nowadays he's extremely good for early game exchanges, because he just wins. When you have a spell that deals 90 damage and heals you 90, it's 180 damage exchange for a 70 mana cost, I think it is, in level 1. It's incredible. You can't fight this guy in a one-on-one with a support or a core most of the time.
It also helps that he's got absurd move speed, 315 base.
Yeah, his move speed, good stats, exactly.
Yeah.
There's an early Rubick.
It's good against the Bane.
Very good against Bane.
Yeah, don't think we've seen it that early, though.
Alright, EHOME are going to just continue to ban the Lycan.
They really didn't like that in game one, did they?
Which is weird, because they beat it.
Yeah.
Like, pretty heavily, too.
Yep.
This was too easy. We're looking for a bigger challenge.
These are two teams who played each other a lot, though, so and have so done so in the past as well. So they probably know the strength of Sylar, and maybe they just really don't like playing against split push. I imagine EHOME could have potentially banned out Nature's Prophet against Alliances as well.
The Brood's gone this time.
I think they should ban the Ember. Both Rubick and Tusk are decent against it. Yeah, okay. There we go.
What a genius you are, Jacob. What do you ban this time around, though? Probably don't even want to pick the Earthshaker, right? Against Tusk Rubick? Getting Fissure Stolen is so miserable.
Undying, Nightstalker, two heroes that comes to mind.
They banned out the Dazzle.
LGD's two supports are both good against the Ness.
I think Undying has some merit to it, though. Especially the way that you fight around the Winner's Curse. If he just drops Tombstone, it's good counter-initiation. I feel like there's so many core heroes, though, that you have to take care of that. Unless you find one to be incredibly striking, you don't even bother banning it out.
They haven't banned the Wisp bit yet, which they banned in the second phase in both the first two games.
That's a good point.
What are the core heroes left that are incredibly contested by both teams? Windranger, potentially. I don't really see Old Chicken play that hero, though.
It's not that contested. It went through last game.
Yeah, I don't think so either.
If anything, Tiny.
Yeah, they had a lot of success.
Gyro.
Gyro, yeah.
Gyro's probably the number one hero, yeah.
I don't think LGD will ban it. I think they want it. And they're just thinking about what counter to their draft they want to ban, and then they'll insta-pick Gyro after this. Seems pretty straightforward for Salar to go that route. And I guess the reason EHOME didn't ban IO is just that LGD opened up with two supports. Like, there's very little chance that LGD will play either of these as a core. It's so unusual.
The offlane mid Winter Wyvern?
Offlane Wyvern is very rare.
They banned one of the better heroes, though, against the Gyrocopter, yeah. That Aghanim's piercing Lina.
I think they heard Trolls talking about it.
Yeah, so they were... I guess they're thinking, okay, EHOME won't go for Lesh again. They could try another of those Spellburst heroes that could become a problem. They feel like they've got pretty good control of the physical damage by having Cold Embrace, and of course they have Defensive Nightmare. They even have Enfeeble against it. So they just need to take out the main magic threats. I think Lina is a great ban.
We saw in the VP game how strong AM is when you're playing against a core Gyro, just because you can kind of out-farm him like crazy, because the Gyrocopter almost always has to come to fights, but they've got a Winter Wyvern and a Bane, two of the better heroes against AM. So I don't think that's a hero that you have to worry about. And like Jacob said, EHOME, they've gone for the Tiny once again.
There is a Wisp available to them this time around, with Tusk going into the offlane instead.
Do EHOME play that frequently?
Lennon?
Yeah, I know he can play it, but I just don't recall seeing EHOME run it for a long time. Had they played at this tournament and I just didn't see that game, or...?
No.
It was EHOME banning it the previous games, right? Against LGD. No, it was LGD banning it?
Yeah, it was LGD.
Oh, I see.
Banned,
okay.
Banned it in second phase both games.
Okay.
So they obviously know something.
You still need a core, though, for CTY.
It's still kind of a dangerous proposition going for IO and Rubick as your two supports. It's really not that strong early on, and it's something LGD can take advantage of, because their two supports early and their cores are actually very good in the early stages of the game to put pressure. So,
okay, they don't
something
wish.
Else.
Haka played such a good Bounty Hunter. I can't remember, I think I cast him in one of the group stage games where he was able to snipe a courier, lay down a ward to block the Radiant big camp stack, and he was able to set up the fight for his team, all in the sequence of like 3 minutes.
And it looks like the... Unless this is a CTY Tiny, then the two mid laners this time are missing. They could, of course, put CTY in the safe lane again.
They seem to do that all the time lately. Like, even the Queen of Pain has played safe lane for them.
So if they do that...
It's a good Windranger ban. What do you think of an Alchemist?
For LGD?
Mm-hmm.
It could go okay. It would actually be incredibly hard for EHOME to kill it.
They can prevent his stacks from happening very easily with Bounty Hunter, though. A big part of the hero is securing your own jungle, and that's like the number one hero you don't want to play against. To do that.
I'm a little bit worried, though, Sindarin. If you look at EHOME's lineup, they don't have a lot of damage. Like, their two supports, Rubick is not a damage dealing support. Bounty Hunter is not a hero that you want to get in close and right-click and shuriken with. And even Tusk, most of the time they build utility now. There is some burst damage on that hero, but especially as an offlaner, I feel like you get slowed down a little bit too much. So EHOME, it feels like they're kind of in the same predicament they were last game, where they need a hero that can assault towers, but at the same time, draw a lot of attention.
I think Viper is good again.
Venomance.
I don't think Venomancer is that good.
He's a very well-rounded lineup.
Okay. And we're going to give it to Lashrak once more. Okay, game three is upon us. The decider in this lower bracket. LGD versus EHOME with LD and Melini.
Thank you very much, Paul. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. We are live here for our deciding game number three at the Frankfurt Major. LGD versus EHOME. One of these teams will be going home. I'm LD. I'm joined, of course, by Ben again. Ben, do you have a favorite here in the draft?
I have to go with EHOME. I kind of thought they were going to win this series much easier than they did. It looks like pretty much the same, very similar lineup to game number two.
And going into that draft, you thought there was a chance maybe the Lashrak could get out of control. We didn't really see it. They go back to the well. I guess A little bit of a difference here because they go for some different supports. They get the Rubick, who can be a big playmaker. They also grab the Bounty Hunter, who can accelerate your team's income heading into the late game. So maybe they can get the gold advantage.
I expected the Bounty Hunter to come out in game number two, actually. I think it would have worked much better for them than the Night Stalker, although they probably drafted it in response to the Ember Spirit. So, yeah, we'll see. I do like their Bounty Hunter play a lot, though.
All right. Well, with that, guys, it's time. The teams have just entered the map, and in a moment, we will be as well. LGD versus EHOME. Only one team can survive the day. The other. Their road ends here. A lot of storylines coming into this match. You've got Lanham, RTK, old friends facing off. Of course, MMY, one of those wily veterans, along with DDC. Sylar, been on this LGD team, it seems, for ages. EHOME, the team with some new faces to the pro scene.
Three Mingos overall. Got to keep that in mind for later, LD.
Okay, very important, Ben. That's the real storyline. We'll have an early pause here, and again, a very similar pattern of warding for both teams. We see that TP and mid drop the ward up towards the Radiant Ancients from LGD. We see the TP bottom drop the lane ward for EHOME. Wonder if either teams had a chance to look at those replays and maybe get some D ward off.
Well, it looks like 11 might have a better start this game because LGD is actually in the EHOME jungle. Looks like that difficult to D ward sentry will be placed again. Vici had a lot of trouble dewarding that one yesterday.
Yeah, EHOME are going to send three heroes towards their own agents, so the old 11 now will back off. And I'm just patrolling in a swivel mode here towards the bottom side of the map, and Kaka is going to go invis. Sylar is actually the only guy up towards this top rune right now. Four heroes heading bottom.
He might get snowballed on if he goes too deep, but they have Ives.
Where do you expect the Bounty Hunter pressure this game? We've seen so many different ways to run it. Pressure your own safe lane at times, go on mid, try to shut down the jungle game early on, even gank the snipe the courier. Like, where is the ideal place to you for Kaka to go?
Well, it looks like Rubick's already starting off bottom to handle the clockwork, so not bottom, mid potentially, but we've seen a lot of Bane just stick around in mid, so likely not mid as well. I would say actually top to give 11 the start that he needs. He's actually doing some creep blocking with level 1 ice shards as opposed to his very early level 1 snowball last game. Looks like he just wants to secure himself level 2 this game.
Yeah, meanwhile, very nice block in Sylar's.
The chicken?
For Sylar as well. Kaka was scouted moving through here. That dire sentry ward still operational, but Kaka did manage to figure out where it is just by how long they were tracing him. Gets the D ward off, has one more sentry available. MMY, just the dust. The other dire sentry, not sure, don't think, yeah, oh, they dropped a bottom to block the camp, so they don't have anything else to deal with this bounty, but I guess the solution then is maybe they just leave the Bane mid longer.
Do you think the Leshrac's better in this game?
Good, really good against TA until she gets BKB. Very tough against Clockwork, though, don't you think? That's one of the best heroes to shut down Lesh normally.
I guess they have the Rubick to lift the Clockwork out of the cogs in case, and they have also good setup for the Leshrac stun, so
I actually feel like last game was an okay Lesh game. I just felt like they didn't get enough mileage out of him before the BKBs came out.
Yeah, well, a lot of that had to do with the Tiny not really being able to convert into a big team finder like they wanted him to.
So I mean, maybe that's where we see the adjustment in build from Olchek, and perhaps he does go for that quick Aghanim Scepter, even like a moderately timed one. It was 42 minutes in, he still couldn't keep up and farm with anyone.
But they're actually able to secure a lot of 11's levels this game, though. He's level 2.5 already. I think at this point he was still level 1 in the last game. So, I mean, MMY kind of focusing his resources elsewhere because of the pesky Bounty Hunter.
At the same time, the Tiny doesn't have the easiest lane here. Up against a dual lane, now a double damage rune on MMY, as though the lane wasn't already hard enough. So he will be struggling quite a bit. And I'm just not really sure where Kaka's going to be able to go. This top lane, kills will not be too easy to come by. Unless they're able to trap the Wyvern, but even then, you've always got the Arctic Burn to get yourself away.
At least he can block the spawn, though. They don't have any detection left. The only detection that they have is the dust on Bane. Actually, he recently picked up some sentry wards, so look for early kill on Bounty Hunter, perhaps. He is still only level 1. I'm not sure if he's going to be able to get the eyes on MMY in time. He has not walked in range of that Observer Ward yet.
Oh, he is going to counter D ward mid lane, so now they have the sentry. Bounty can't really easily come in, and then MMY will make his journey top lane as the pressure was mounting a bit.
The Sylar laying off the Rocket Barrage here, but they get the shards grabbed. Do they want to go on Sylar? It's a level 2 barrage, and
they don't have Janata.
Why streams into the lane, but I believe was scouted out by that Radiant Observer.
Yeah, it was kind of going on while they were harassing the gyrocopter, but
he was on the map, but yeah, maybe they weren't actually watching.
No Janata, no Oof. I don't think it's going to be a kill, but they really need to be able to put out some more pressure on Bounty Hunter, and the chicken is not even having to go a different route because of Bounty Hunter's visibility on the map.
Yeah, it's kind of reminiscent of like a Clockwork when he hits 6, where the less you're on the map, often the better it is for the team's overall strategy, but he is going to make that rotation now. Maybe the counter D ward, we'll see. Still, maybe his farm, not even slightly contested, 25 and 9 mid, and this is now without any backup required. I'll just kind of chuckle at Kaka poking his head out.
He doesn't actually have a Tango to eat the ward, so he's not even sure if he's going to get the ward kill, because maybe he can kill it in 2 hits. It'll probably take Bounty Hunter 3, almost 4 hits.
Yeah, it's not like the Tiny can easily get in there. He's going to try for it. 1, 2. Actually, might take 4 hits. Indeed. Oh, well, all the sentry's gone now. Nobody's going to have fun mid.
Yeah, but Kaka had to expend his entire HP and mana pool. Maybe he'll get some bottles from Old Chicken to keep him in the game.
So they're farming the TA. The Gyro's farm isn't the best, but we generally look at Gyro as a hero that needs levels more early on, and he's already level 5 as they make their go, trying to catch out the Bane, and it will be a first blood. At long last, EHOME make the connection. It's Old 11 joining the fight a bit later on, but they found the opening bed. It took a while, but they were persistent.
It's a good play from Old Chicken. I think the bottle is kind of what made pulled LGD into that position. Firstly, they didn't expect to have the Observer Ward up there, and they didn't expect Bounty Hunter to return so quickly, because when he invis, he looked like he had no mana and was just going to return home to heal. So that was really good for them. I don't know, maybe they had the Observer Ward on the Dire side to see that he was like bottling someone that wasn't himself, which would have tipped them off to the Bounty Hunter there, but didn't look like they were actually looking. And now Bounty Hunter died, fills out the bottle for Old Chicken.
Toss back mid lane. Old Chicken's gonna try for it, the long range throw, and then get slowed down. The courier just kind of scouting this out. Maybe does not have any more defensive refraction charges, but with no Oove, doesn't seem they have the pursuit necessary. Might not even have been able to kill him anyways. MMY was on the chase. And
yeah, need more body blocks for that to happen.
It does highlight a bit of a worry for this lineup that outside of the Lash, they are very much lacking on the damage over time for the TA.
So 11 and ROTK are very close in terms of experience and net worth. So we'll maybe be able to see 11 match ROTK's wild performance from last game.
I don't know if any that was a 1 in a million.
Kaka's expecting a chicken, and he's gonna have to be pretty patient if he wants to wait here.
Yeah, he's tired of the old chicken. He wants the young donkey. The one with wings.
Is that really a young donkey?
It's gotta be younger.
It's gonna walk right
it
over
can
him,
fly,
though.
Man. It's gotta be healthy.
Oh, just
and the timing's not quite right.
I mean, maybe he can get
on the way back. Yeah. Still, actually, no speed burst. This could be a kill.
Nope.
No, they're playing discipline against the bounty, and that's what you gotta do. Very nicely played by LGD. Might not be the flashiest, but it is important to avoid giving up that extra gold. Also would have hurt the TA quite a bit. Speaking of the TA, we are starting to see a little bit of stacking in the jungle, but not much. No ancients as of yet. Still, maybe it's doing a great job in the lane.
Rubik's already level 4. That's actually very high for a support at this point in the game, and he was able to, you know, be somewhat involved in the TA attempt in the mid. So, unfortunately, he's not able to stack so much for the Tiny, but that's okay. Tiny can come back through kills. He's not even that under-farmed.
He's actually looking for some action now. Moving towards the top lane, there is no Dire Vision here. They've got purely the lane ward in the bottom room. This could be an opening. The Avalanche coming out as they snowball forward onto Sylar. Easy grab. EHOME back to playing their style of Dota, run at you and just blow you up at the very start of the game.
Kaka's set a really good foundation of wards, though. They always keep track of MMY, and they know that he bypassed that mid ward, and that leaves it a 3-on-2 situation in the top end. Even if he's able to TP, he's not going to prevent that kill on the gyrocopter. He has to like be there exactly at the right time to sleep Tiny before the combo, or sleep gyro as the Sun Toss combo is coming out, and it's just good play by Bounty Hunter, making this early game work.
And then even better news, they also managed to clear out a small stack there, so denying some income to the gyro as well as the TA. Two heroes, they can easily clear those out.
But they don't have any detection in the top lane.
They might go again. It's a bootsless DDC. itemless.
Yes. Oh, sorry, boots. Yeah, that's what I meant to say. Inventoryless. Okay, he wants.
Is he gonna get it?
Close. Come on, give me my boots. He's naked.
And even MOI, I guess he has one sentry left on him, and they do have a sentry in the mid lane, so they can feel relatively safe there. But Bounty Hunter getting his levels.
He didn't get them. He's like, oh, I got to pull first. The life of a support. 469 net worth.
And Lanham equal on experience with ROTK. So they're going to hit level 6 pretty darn soon.
Meanwhile, LGD are on a smoke mission.
Old Chicken stealing that double stack.
Well, while that's happening, though, they are making their jump on the bottom lane. They're going to find Lanham. There's the sleep setup. They're going to deploy the trap here momentarily, looking for the cogs. They wrangle him in. Lanham with the toss back on the TA, gets off the fade bolt, and still does go down. But meanwhile, mid lane, they're also making the go. Snowball forward onto DDC. The Apo toss punch. Easy. And like you said, EHOME, while that was all happening, also managed to steal the big stack of neutrals. So they took away two double stacks.
Lottom's like, really? Me? You guys are going to commit three heroes to kill not even a level 6 Rubick?
No mercy.
Yeah, they got a lot more out of that.
CTY was scouted here, though. Oh, there's a lane ward. There's an invis rune. They might need a little more firepower. The cooldown's going to come in. CTY, he's got a TP scroll, and it's already too late. Down he goes. Nice job by LGD. The lane ward. The wards in general have just been huge this game.
Mm-hmm. And maybe doing a good job of getting kills on either side of the map.
So now that we enter the mid game, Ben, what are the next big things that your eyes are on?
As usual, the blink dagger for Tiny. It's going to be key for them to just get the jump on them. And not really sure what CTY is going for. I guess maybe a Bloodstone again. I would maybe like to see him vary up builds so he can actually just get in and get out really quickly. But
so would you rather see like a Yule Scepter first then?
I mean, he also still has to deal with the Clockwork too. So he does want that nice HP buffer. But Bloodstone doesn't really give you any armor. So
they have the lift, the snowball as well. The cooldown's cooling down for 8 seconds again with the walrus punch. The Ava's there. EHOME just always bringing numbers to the point of attack, but in the mid lane there's a hook, grabs out CTY. He already got the pulse nova activated in RTK. No blade mail at this stage, way too early for that, so he is not gonna risk it. That's well, were they thinking about tusk?
They saw three TPs coming in, so yeah,
that as well.
That's what he knows. It's time to bail. But
get the hell out. And he has gone for his typical rocket flare mag, so not that much damage.
The key for me last game was keeping 11 underleveled, and now that he's like level 6, he's been involved in 3 kills. He's actually level 8 right now, and
yeah, offlane, schmofflane, it doesn't feel like it.
That's just the pressure of having the bounty hunter run around, though. And now they don't even need a shadow blade this game on the Tiny. The threat of the bounty hunters enough to make them invest a lot of money into the sentry ward, so that when Tiny gets his blink, they're not going to have glimmers, they're not going to have four staffs, and they're not going to have a gem potentially for the bounty hunter.
Well, LGD, same smoke that we saw before, but EHOME seemed to be wise to this one. It's only the bounty hunter bottom, and he's hiding in the trees. They do have dust as well as a sentry, so maybe they catch him out, but he's already level 6. Not really the biggest deal, even if he does die. Elsewhere, CTY is going to roam towards top. They've got 11 ready to roll in.
Oh, they're scouting out. They actually expect a smoke down here. Look at that rocket coming out. It did scout out. Gyrocopter looks like they pinged out on him. But if not, then this Observer Ward will certainly see MOI running around.
Yeah, CTY is going to get scouted out here now by the Dire side, but still they're pressing up.
It's a different build by maybe, though. They actually want to get a lot of kills. Generally, you see Desolator first on TA, especially on Dire, but
there's the jump in, a commitment here onto ROTK, not having that explosive start that he did in game number 2. And EHOME, the hits just keep on coming. Another takedown. They now have access to a single point in Diabolic Dedic. Better to push the tower faster. And while that's going on, Kaka holds the line bottom lane, already 2 tracks out. They may have to think twice about this push, Ben. Too many track kills here could really cause things to fall apart. And there is a glyph about to come off.
Oh, what a nice rocket. It's got all 3 of their heroes down on bottom. 2 of them were tracked up.
Oh, they were fishing with the shards. Didn't quite get the connection there. But LGD can't push, they're too afraid of the track kills.
Yeah, maybe they can use a surprise blink dagger burst from TA to secure them a kill. They're trying to fight fire with fire, which is really dangerous versus a bounty hunter.
Not to mention a Tiny with a blink and a double damage room, but they are going to go for the jump. RTK looks for the hook, but ends up hitting Kaka there. Invis currently. Now they're going to pop the dust. He gets pushed back into the trees. They find one. Can they get the second? The snowball's revving up, but rotations could be coming here. Tiny not yet choosing to join the fight. Looks like they may sack 11. No, he pops the buckler and runs. Heads for the hills with the stick. Lanham's there to try and slow this one down. Where are the other heroes? The Leshrek, the Tiny. It feels like they could get some kills, but they don't want to. They want to split push, so they only lose the bounty hunter at 11. The magic continues. Old Chicken, actually, he got a full tower, so maybe it was worth it in the end. It's tier 1 already down mid.
Yeah, they didn't actually commit the Winner's Curse. They expected a lot more fight from EHOME, but only committing two heroes there, and that's actually not so bad for them. Leshrac getting a tower, Tiny getting a tower in the meantime.
And they got the Bloodstone even faster this time. CTY, I think it was 16 minutes last game. This game, we're looking at 13, and the main reason is they got the towers a lot sooner. So overall, a 2-for-1 tower exchange around the map now. Already rockets coming out towards the Ancients. That has proven to be a really big steal, the vision that it grants Lanham.
Let's see what other items are coming out for EHOME. Mech status halfway complete for him. ROTK closing in on the blade mail. And once you see the chain mail up on Clockwork, that means that Leshrac might be in a little bit of trouble. Maybe having
bottom
a
lane, DDC. He gets trapped out here, was trying to get away with the TP, but not going to happen. The snowball coming forward, and another grab. Old 11. 1-0-4. This is a total
CTY
reversal.
Looking to maybe go on Sylar. He's in a position to stun from the fog.
And they came from behind. Sylar down again. EHOME, everything's working this game, and nothing seems to be going the way of LGD.
Yeah, they're doing a good job of preventing LGD from getting any sort of farm. They're forced to commit all these items to items they don't really want to. Like TA with the blink, you'd ideally want to play more greedy, get Dezo into an Aegis into a blink. You want to be able to get any sort of support items that aren't the blue Observer Wards. And of course the BKBs, which really stymied the damage from Leshrac last game. So this is, yeah, way more successful from them.
And they're getting to play their style, which is just they're on offense. They're the ones map controlling. 11 is getting chased a bit bottom, but Lanham's already moving to position to help him out. He does have the stolen Arctic burn for an extra bit of mobility. Sentries are up now. They are walking past some dire wards. They're probably going to realize it soon. That first sentry planted, it could be a twofer. Let's see if he goes for the burn. And what do you know? Lanham got at it again. He gets the D ward right outside the rush pit. While that's going on, DDC is trying to set up. 4CTY gets up the curse, and now Baby jumps forward. There's the initial meld, and it's enough to get the kill. CTY still a bit squishy. And while that was happening, Old Chicken strikes again. He isolates RTK in the woods, combos him down, kills all over the place simultaneously. Looking for a bit more. Old 11. He could go back in. Can't believe DDC stuck around, but hey, free track gold for EHOME.
LGD cannot keep splitting up like this. They're giving track gold after track kill. I think that was three heroes getting two track kills, and that is worth your Leshrac.
The lift now from Rubik onto maybe throwing out the avalanche, but he gets tossed back away from EHOME. Seems they want to retreat.
They're waiting for Leshrac to file in, and now that he's made his way from the T1 tower.
They have the snowball. They could prep for this. They're going to start it off with the shards. Another beautiful grab. Now the toss up. The smackdown. He's done again. KO'd. Furious. They still have the snowball. RTK's committed onto the tusk, but he's able to roll his way out of this one. Old Chicken looking for a follow-up combo. EHOME just decimating LGD. Getting the tracks out and not even allowing them to fight.
Oh, you guys want more track kills? Oh, okay. Here, we'll do some more track gold. They have to play a lot tighter. They have to utilize their ultimates a lot better. Winter's Curse into like a huge cooldown, for example, or even like a hookshot into cooldown so they can quickly kill high priority targets. Like I would say the Bounty Hunter is very big. Leshrac, we saw how easy it was for them to take him down on the Leshrac down on the top lane, but they just haven't really been together.
And it doesn't really seem like they have
Where's this chicken? Oh, okay. Yeah, I mean, they might die from the blink. They're all smoked up.
Another contribution.
You never know.
Take our donkey. Well, just let us live, please. Sylar, he gets rolled on. He gets punched up. He does have a cooldown available. But then the Rubik gets chucked in. Lanham is stuffed right through the hoop. Another kill for EHOME. Old Chicken getting the last hit there. Everything going their way. EHOME. They really feel like they're in the comfort zone right now.
Oh, you mean you're not supposed to give them track kills?
You mean Rubik's not supposed to be able to,
it's a little hard,
to get tossed on a gyro and just walk away?
Yeah, I mean, I suppose with the tiny blink, like, no one really feels safe, but, I mean, so many track goals. They have one observer ward out, but EHOME are not on that side of the map anymore.
And to make matters worse, this game he's going eggs as well as leading 9-0-1.
And Gyrocopter forced to commit for an early BKB build, but this time it's going to be much later than the last, and TA is the only hero with any semblance of net worth in that sea of green.
A whiffed hookshot mid lane, not that I'm sure it would have amounted to all that much, but already a backup on old 11 and gold besides.
I mean, I think at this point, LGD just have to continuously smoke and smoke and smoke so that EHOME, like, kind of get pushed back in their map control. They lost
that, but they have none available and one up in 1 minute.
I think they had to do something. They already lost all control of their own jungle. Two towers down, nothing. I mean, they could potentially sneak Roach. That's also a good play for maybe, but eventually they're going to have to fight him head on, and I honestly don't really think it matters if CA has an Aegis or not, because he can just get stunlocked.
And they've got the damage over time. Until that BKB comes out, maybe, is the man in front
for
now. Oh,
look at Kaka's position.
And they're going to get revealed. There's the shards trapping LGD away. They blink over. They curse and commit onto Kaka. All of this for the Bounty Hunter. But where's the detection? Okay, there you go. They got it. And they will get the kill. But it comes at a cost as MMY still dies. Nothing goes for free this game. And now the chase, the long roll. It might be the 11 show continuing episode. 5 billion.
He isolated his own team out.
Perhaps he's in too far, but they're walking down. Call down's there. Very nice positioning. Keeping the O back. They're just going to throw the Lesh in. It's a Disco Pony Bomb on the DDC, and apparently a very successful one. Netting them yet another kill as maybe is suddenly deep behind enemy lines. The damage over time ticks in for the Pulse Nova. He needs help. He needs backup quickly. They punch him. They beat him down. He's dead again. So they go for more. The slow from the lightning, looking for ROTK. There's another toss. Blake, this time old chicken, doesn't sacrifice the teammate. He'll be the one to take the bullet. Looking for the roll forward from old 11. No, he's going to back off. He's going to reevaluate. They get the grip off an old chicken. That's okay. I got you covered, buddy. Roll in onto Sylar. Ava, toss again, and then punch back up. This guy is just getting knocked around like a ping pong ball. EHOME are styling on LGD.
Tusk is a good hero, man. Just completely countered that Fiend's grip with a defensive snowball. MMY's probably like, that hero.
I love the confidence from EHOME, though, that they basically go back to the same draft from last game. Yeah, the key adjustment, the Bounty Hunter, but the cores, they still had faith in them. They do slightly tweak the builds, but it shows that they didn't panic to the way the last game went, and that may speak to the veteran leadership of Lanham and 71 there.
Mm-hmm. And just the early laning phase going so much better. Like, Tusk, I think, saved the Leshrac with a mech there, and him having levels and farm is actually really important for this team. Oh, Kaka trying to track up some more people, and now we see a blink dagger on Tusk. Oh, random dust.
A random dust, but I think they actually may have seen him coming into this direction. So they almost get the kill of Kaka. He's low. He will finally fall, but it's a track kill again. Oh, Chicken's here. He's got a big old club, too. They do match the Witcher's curse, but he's alive for now. CTY covering the retreat. Gets up the stun on maybe, but now the homie missile slowly coming into position. Can they get the kill? It would be huge. He's 13-0-2. No, the snowball saving him. The shards coming out. He's rolling into the cooldown, though, but he blinks away. Oh, Chicken's out of there. No TP. Hides on the high ground. The rest of the team may suffer. Hold 11 surviving for now. I think old Chicken even wants to go back in if these heroes get low enough. Landham's in position. He brings Sylar low. Get ready for Tony to re-enter. He jumps forward. They gotta kill him off. They need this goal. They're not gonna get it just yet. Sylar down. He can chuck Landham forward maybe. Try to sacrifice his teammate. No, a creep. He dunks him as well. Welcome to the old Chicken show. Hope you enjoy it. Finally, he'll fall. It's a 1400 gold bounty. DDC's the cost though. And they're not done yet. They want more track gold. LGD. Massacred, just annihilated, 5 down, are you not entertained?
What plays coming out from 11?
Jesus.
I mean, the snowball plus blink is pretty darn good. Oh, we must say.
I can't believe that he made it out. He rolled into the cooldown, but the timing was just so crisp.
Also, CTY with a big Yule's play, too. He actually prevented a lot of damage coming out from the Tiny while he was cursed and about to get beaten down by the Templar Assassin. He had the Yule's there, and that kind of bought time for the Tusk to TP into the mid lane with that blink, clutch, snowball mech save.
Are we going to see the 5 blink dagger strat? They've already got three.
Our cameraman has his work cut out for him. Just gonna be heroes like going up and then down and then getting punched up in the air again and tossed back and forth. Who knows?
My advice would just be follow up chicken. Wherever he goes, the action seems to follow. And to be fair, his partner in crime, Old 11, is now 3-0-13. Together, both involved in 17 and 16 kills, respectively. LGD are just really... How do you calm this one down, Ben?
I mean, it's so hard. Like, they try to isolate Hero with the cogs, but then he, like, snowballs through the cogs and picks up the Hero along the way.
Oh, no. You gotta stop chasing LGD.
Like, if Old 11 were there for that Winter's Curse, he probably would have snowballed through and picked up the Cursed Hero along the way, too. Like, these single-target disables are just not cutting it for LGD. They really sorely missed the AoE lockdown from the Earthshaker that they had last game.
Simply incredible stuff here from EHOME. Some younger players, but it doesn't feel like it. They're the ones making all the right moves now. 10 Bloodstone charges up on CTY. Hasn't even had to deliver that explosive performance that we saw out of his Queen of Pain to keep the team in the tournament in some of their key knockout matches earlier. It's been the rest of the squad really stepping up at the critical moments. At last, LGD, they get something. A BKB finally up for Sylar. And they do have that blade mail on the clock for what little good it's done so far, but the shards are fishing, threatening. And now the sigil moves into position. Do they actually try to hold this tier 1 tower? There's the curse. They're committing on an old chicken, but this guy just doesn't seem to die very easily. Force that back, kept alive again. The BKB is already committed. They need this to do a lot of damage. It only connects on two, and they're fairly durable heroes to begin with. Homie missile hits old chicken at first BKB. A total waste, but they're not done yet. Old 11, he gets off the initial shards. They do manage to grip him. Finally, they bring him down. My god, that's overdue. But the trade is the Bane. Again, the sacrificial lamb. An instant buyback on Old 11. There's not even a tier 1 up for this. So he's going to have to run the long way, but that's okay. They still get ROTK. And it looks like the rest of LGD have to back off. And they will be able to press in here for EHOME.
Oh, that counterplay by EHOME. They don't even need a snowball that time. They force staff him out. They lift the clockwork so he can't even cog. And they just wasted Gyro's entire duration of the BKB. But that was a nice play by Bane, finally realizing that Tusk is a big problem gripping up. But then that allowed the Rubik to steal the grip and get another kill.
As though they haven't been, you mentioned, making it hard enough for the cameraman to begin with. But yeah, there's a Rubik in this game, and Lanham has been very impressive. There's now a track deployed on the mid lane for maybe. He will back himself away. Does have the haste turn available, but they insta-smoke. Let's see. Do they think they can cut him off here at the
pass? His blink's still down for 6 seconds.
There's an AC up. Are they going for it? There's the blink, the lift as well. Suddenly, surprise! It's old chicken again. What a way to die. No, the hookshot not even connecting, but maybe able to pop the haste. Can they turn this? Is this the opening? Is this the time? They don't have a Winter's Curse. They still jump in with maybe he wants these kills and he wants them damn bad. A refracted Rubik just blinking here, there, everywhere. Sylar again, another BKB charge, but he's not getting any value out of these, and it's going to end soon. His old chicken looks for the blink tossback. This time he won't find it. A small moment of mercy for LGD.
TAs, I think refracting cooled down like right after the stun toss and the punch coming out from EHOME. I'm so surprised he lived through that fight. But they actually fought without Winter's Curse for that particular engagement, and they were actually in a, LGD had a good positioning on EHOME. There were like four heroes relatively clumped up, a great call down coming out from Sylar, and Winter's Curse was the missing piece to that puzzle for LGD to get back in this game.
They might be able to roach soon, Ben. They've got the AC up now on the Tiny. In fact, maybe even now.
And I think Old Chicken played a much more conservative game than last game. He had his blink, and then he still waited until a good time to fight. Like, generally, when you get your blink, you're like, okay, I can fight right now. I'm really powerful. Like, I can do whatever I want, but he...
I am tiny.
He waited for his threat to... Oh, and a smoke pop by Kaka.
Oh, who is it again? It's the pesky little yellow goblin. What else is new? And now Old Chicken, he's going to engage. He's the Aegis carry. They get off the shard. Perfect positioning, keeping MMY out of the fight. The cooldown's there. It's not a bad one by any means. It does do a lot of damage to CTY. They've also managed to finish off Old Chicken, but it cost them a grip. On round two of the fight, will they be able to get the job done? Lanham here, still with the refraction, they get that second kill. Tiny now slept, this could be the turnaround potentially. They need Lanham to steal something, help out Old Chicken, he chunks out one! ROTK also maybe brought to safety, maybe this until the shuriken bounces through, but at long last they will slay the beast! There you go, my god, that took ages, 16-2-4. He'll finally drop, and that's going to allow them to buy a BKB here in the TA as Lanham, but that stolen refraction for now, trying to retrieve the blink cooling down, like a magician, will jump away, goes for the TP out, and he's sort of disabled. Nothing.
Wow, what a sick individual play coming out from Lanham right there. He blinked in, he fade bolted the gyrocopter knowing that his track kill would be worth more than his own life, and managed to steal refraction so that he could actually blink out in the end.
Yeah, he has been sitting on that refraction a bit. It's a sick play, but I guess you'd love to see him get like the bigger spells here. The grip, which he stole earlier, the curse.
Hey, getting a kill on solo kill on gyrocopter in that fight, that's pretty big on its own.
But still in the end, there's a win for LGD though. They get rid of the Aegis. The gold actually swings their way against the bounty hunter, no less.
They
needed that.
They were able to eliminate the Tusk very early on in the fight. This time they committed a winner's curse onto him, and he's actually, I guess, the only one that can get counterplay that. I guess maybe the Rubick can steal it, but that's, you know, counting on Winter Wyvern not using a spell after his winner's curse.
Are you downing Lanham's ascension to godhood? Did you not see how much he Columbus?
Oh my.
But Tusk has to be very careful about its positioning and wait for the blink dagger. Like, you want to be close enough so that you can like snowball through the Winter's Curse to pick up the hero along the way, but not close enough so that you get actually hit by the Winter's Curse. But it looked like he actually wanted to blink and punch someone, and that put him in a compromising position right next to the Tiny.
And now a gem is purchased by LGD. They've been hounded by this bounty hunter, had to spend a lot of money on dust, on sentries, and oftentimes he has prevented them from getting those clean initiations, but at long last they get the map control item here. Now the question will be, how long can DDC hold on to this?
And keep in mind, LGD were fighting under this Observer Ward too, who had full vision of EHOME.
Do they want to go for a play here now? They deny the tower mid.
I mean, they're still way stronger than LGD. So they just have to make sure that they protect the Tusk. So Tusk just needs to protect himself for once.
I do like this pickup here from CTY, going for the Force Staff.
Uh-oh, Tiny's not actually there for the fight. I guess it's close to the T2, but LGD...
He has a TP.
Seeing that he's split-pushing, I mean, still, it might be over. By the time, like, a Winter's Curse plus Calldown happens, it might be too late for him to save his team. And old 11 will be in sight, actually.
They're gonna look for the jump here. They get off that Fiend's Grip to start things off, but Lanham's there. He gets the lift, he steals the grip, and now he tries to turn it, but quickly has to cancel the run. Too much magic damage on the Lanham, the Calldown. Very well positioned, gonna hit up four heroes, but is there follow-up for this? Tiny's arrived. Daddy's home. He wants a little revenge. Charging forward, the shard's not quite there. Actually pushing RDK away with the avalanche, the toss, a glimmer back. They get LGD frantically retreating as this rampaging Tiny hunts them down into the river. Still RDK's track. They go for the shards again, trapping him almost within his own cogs. And then at long last, the stun will finish him off. So they get the track kill there. Quite a few heroes participating in that.
So very quick.
And even trade because of the lead.
Nice four staff coming out from Bounty Hunter to save the Tusk in that fight. I think if not for that, they would have actually picked off like two heroes, the Rubick and the Tusk, very early on into the fight, and then they can commit to the T2 push. So that was a really clutch four staff. A
tithe to the impurity. This Tiny is very big. Yasha now up. I was going to say before that broke out, I like the four staff pickup here from CTY is... Nobody else on EHOME is opting to go for one early, aside from Kakas, and they've got multiple ways to deal with the Clockwork initiation.
Yeah, I think even more so, they can protect the Tusk. If they protect the Tusk can protect them, and then LGD don't really know who to initiate on, but as of the few last fights, LGD, they recognize that killing Tusk and disabling him is the best way for them to win the team fight. And until EHOME proves otherwise, I think they're going to continue on with that plan.
It's the Manta style, coming out soon for Old Chicken. An old classic on Tiny. See a little bit less of it nowadays, but we'll bring it back. CTY just sitting on the static 8 Bloodstone charges, but in addition to the 4 staff, also did grab a Boots of Travel previously, so the mobility here, extremely high for EHOME. They've got, what's that, 3 blinks, 2 4 staffs, 1 BOTs, the toss, the snowball, the invis of the bounty hunter. They're pretty much everywhere whenever they want to be.
Yeah, they have a lot of armor on EHOME too. We see the AC already built up on the Tiny, the Vlads on the Bounty Hunter. I actually think they really need a Solar Crest. I would like to see one of these Force Staff Bearers go for a Solar Crest instead. It really helps versus the Winter's Curse as well as the TA.
Maybe poking his head out. This is dangerous here. He's going to walk in Old Chicken, quickly jumps away, but Old Chicken gets the vision of him. It's now daytime, manages to fight the avalanche. BKB is committed. He gets chucked back right into CTY's clutches, then tries for the TP out, but Walrus Punch says no, it's a 5-0 track kill. Oh, goodness.
And on TA, no less.
And no, actually does have the buyback, but that is devastating if she has to use it. That was a 2,000 gold swing when they're already up by 15,000, it looks like.
Yeah, he was farming out pretty dangerously. All their observer wards are on their side of the map, and farming their jungle without eyes on them is very risky. If it's like a support, I guess it can only be Bane at this point, because Winter Wyvern has a gem, like kind of the way Kaka's been playing, and tank the ganks like that, then it's fine. But you can't lose your largest net worth hero like that.
And here's the high ground breach. We never really saw it attempted by EHOME last game. They are looking for it now. They're just going to throw C3 at him. I mean, why not? He's pretty much never gonna die. And if he does, it's because old Chicken gets to do what he wants. The stun is there on RTK. He has to be quickly removed and disengaged from the fight. CTY will allow the homie missile to connect, but this frees up old Chicken to go hard on the tier 3. He'll bring it down. EHOME closing in on what could be their first lane of racks and perhaps the beginning of the end here for LGD. Their Frankfurt Major dreams are faced by a very angry rock with a large stick. The Manta now complete. RTK, thinking about the hook. And then thinking he likes living a little bit more.
I like the Manta pickup here for Tiny. It allows him to like blink in, stun toss someone, and then immediately Manta so that he can't get focused down by the Winter's Curse or the Fiend's Grip by Bane.
Helps you siege as well.
Yeah, helps you siege as well. But they've been pretty hesitant to go in, because every time the Tusk has tried to go in, he's just been disabled by one of those. So now they can kind of rely on the Tiny to blink in. A safer build would have been a BKB, which also, I guess, helps with Tower Siege. But Manta gives you a lot more damage.
So they will finish off the Ancients here. LGD tentatively poking out of their base, but only for a moment. Sylar using the Rocket Barrage to clean up this big camp near the dire side of the map, but you never really see LGD go past the river. It's been a long time since they've had that level of confidence. Knowing the tier 3's down, one bad fight could easily spell the end of this game. They are just waiting for mistakes from EHOME, but so far, EHOME, they haven't made too many. And even if they do, they've always got that track insurance policy.
Yeah, Sylar.
I'm okay with renaming it. It's like all he's been playing lately.
He's like 5,000 below the Lesh rank and 7,000 below Tiny. He's just been dying in a lot of these fights, 4 and 7 on him without the luxury of refraction. And the Cold Embrace has just not been very useful in saving him this game. And no Glimmer Keep Up on Winter Wyvern.
So there was a rocket just fired by LGD into that Radiant Jungle, but EHOME smoked just seconds before it fully connected. And they don't even realize that this jump's about to happen. They could easily get caught out. It's Enlanum who starts the fight. The quick toss up onto Sylar, who's Glimmered and kept alive. And now they get off the curse, focusing down on Chicken. He needs some help. The snowball's coming. It is going to save him. Once again, it's 11, trying to turn the fight around and beating down onto DDC. Beautiful appraise, keeping himself alive. The TA still not being focused down. Old Chicken almost dead. Sylar has to finish him off, really desperately needs to, but CTY going back in, trying to cover his comrade Old Chicken. Does he re-engage? Even a catapult have been turned into weapons of war. So much for them throwing things. He's throwing them, maybe, on the run. Blinks away in the end. Only a 1-for-1 there. And it looks like a gem did hit the deck in the midst of that, but the Radiant will recover their own as 11 fishes. Oh, what was that? That was a vacuum shard. Somehow just sucks the TA in. Not gonna follow it up, though.
Oh, they would have had so many more kills if Bounty Hunter were still alive. Like, I think 3 heroes were invisible without the gem and the help with the track vision. Still, EHOME get a very quick and easy roast for them. And this does not bode well.
Aegis up on Old Chicken, and I mean, we saw he is killable. Almost, if he goes in that hard, but
he was really late to his Manta, though. The full duration, I think, gripped him because of that.
He's been soaking up so many spells, which is what I like about how he's playing. Just goes in, they commit the curse on him, the grip on him, and even if he dies, the Leshrac does whatever he wants the entire fight. Much different from last game.
Well, looks like LGD right about to walk in the vision of
they're confident. Hey, they do have the Aegis, but this is pretty far to go. The blink's available. No vision. It's a little bit dangerous in these waters. EHOME won't take a dip.
I mean, EHOME have that bloodlust, though. You always get that mentality when you have the track on your team. You're like, let's look for some more kills.
Also, when you're tiny and you're this far, you actually feel like you're Godzilla. Beauty humans.
Well, no T3 left up in the mid lane as a result of the siege maybe 10 minutes ago. And I don't... If they play it correctly, like, Tusk buys his Solar Crest, and then they have Tiny up front sieging the range racks, then LGD is going to have a really hard time counterplaying it. They have to kind of make sure that EHOME doesn't get that slow siege positioning off that is really hard to break with the AoE that they have.
They're going to use these illusions to scout a bit, and they'll reveal a chicken over in the mid lane, quickly clears out the wave, backs off to his team.
I think they actually want to... It'd be smart for them to go for like a fake push on bottom and then smoke through the mid when LGD isn't expecting it. They do have a smoke up on the bounty hunter, but looks like just waiting for a better time in the mid lane.
Oh, CTY, they are going to find that ward. One swipe of the tree. Down it goes. Bottom lane pushing in, top lane pushing in, all lanes going the way of EHOME. The whole game going the way of EHOME right now as they lead by 20,000 gold, 20,000 experience, zeroing in on a win. And with that, their old leader would be knocked down. Old Chicken is going to commit. He jumps in. He gets caught by a grip. The four step number one is going to try to protect him. The call down's there. Everybody from EHOME scrambles. Only old 11 really gets hit by the full brunt of it. He's still got a snowball and he's just baiting and baiting. They Greaves up. Now they look for the turn. They've got the meld on Lanham again. And in comes the tiny. Oh, he went for the chuck back. He only gets the creep. A rare miss. Manta dodging though. That last auto attack. He's able to survive. Hangs on. EHOME rushing again. Now the Yule set up. The gyrocopter's whole combo has been expended. Do they have much follow up? The curse! My god! CTY! That is just brutal, savage stuff. Maybe getting the last hit. They needed something like that out of DDC. And as Old Chicken blinks in, the sleep was already being prepped up for him, but it gets taken off. He's still clubbed down. They can't stop this man. He's just too damn big. He's still got the friggin' ages, for Christ's sake. Three are dead. Four likely to follow. Sylar hanging on. He sees his TA die before his very eyes, and he will be next. The double buyback. A triple buyback for whatever it's worth. LGD, their last legs here at Frankfurt, desperately hanging on by a thread, by a prayer, and maybe not for much longer. They lift up Sylar, they toss him up and down, they beat him all around until he can't even see any which way but a path back to the well. He gets off the call and trying to survive for now, but he's thrown up again, and maybe two. Remember, he just fought back as well. The gyro's down, more will follow. ROTK, maybe every last LGD hero slaughtered in front of their own tier 4. There's no mercy whatsoever. EHOME looking savage here in game number 3. This was one of the biggest thrashings of the Frankfurt Major.
Reminding everybody why Tusk is still a top tier pick. Excellent plays from 11 all around, and it looks like Bounty Hunter was the missing piece of the puzzle that EHOME were looking for in game number 2.
It really does feel like it was the difference maker. At first, we didn't see the pressure, but the Tusk got so much out of the lane, and from there, they just played EHOME Dota. That's what they wanted.